Isn't he worthy? Isn't he worthy? Isn't he worthy? You in your right mind because he's worthy. Come on. You ain't hopeless because he's worthy. Come on, come on, come on. Hallelujah. 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 I'm still alive because he's worthy. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We give you praise, God. I don't care how much trouble you go through, you're still here. Hallelujah. Oh my God, you ought to be grateful. The Bible said thanksgiving is the will of God. Come on. Giving him thanks is the will of God. You want to be in the will giving thanks. Hallelujah. You don't understand. If you're still breathing, you got a chance to turn your life around. Glory to God. Come on. Hallelujah. If you're still breathing, there's still purpose left for you. Oh my God, you contending unto Bahake. You ain't like the hopeless. Come on, you got hope in the kingdom of God. Say, I got hope in the kingdom of God. Many times we let life's battles break us down. But God is trying to tell you, if you're still breathing, you have overcoming power in your belly. Life's battles is nothing compared to what you carry on the inside of you. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Anything that's external is an inferior power. You got greater power inside of you. You don't have to break within breaking situations. You are the overcomer. Get excited enough about what God has placed on the inside of us. We don't get excited enough about what he has brought us out of. Come on. Oh, you, the reason you're in is because he brought you out. Go through your life and count the battles you've already overcome. You ought to be grateful. It wasn't because you did it on your own. It's because God brought you through. Every situation. You are supposed to be in the grave, but you ain't. Everything you've done, you're supposed to be in the grave, but you ain't. You ain't in the grave. You ain't, come on, say, I ain't in the grave. The reason I ain't in the grave, in my mess, he was covering me. Come on, Shapa. Rekante bateba. You ain't lying. You ain't got to believe me. Hato. Rekante banabakataya. I see the investment. I see the calling. I see what I placed on the inside of them. And they're crazy as they want to be. But while they in their craziness, I stepped in and covered them anyway. Why? Because I put in them what I want to get out of them. You ain't nothing but dumb sheep, but God himself is the one that makes you wise. He's the one that gives you intelligence. He's the one that causes you to rise out of dumb situations. As you follow him, I say, my sheep know my voice. You need a shepherd. You're not smart enough to live on your own as a sheep. You think you can do this on your own? You crazy. Ain't no way. No way a sheep can live on their own. You're taking yourself down the pathway of death. You need a shepherd. Hallelujah. 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 If you ain't giving your life to the shepherd, you crazy. Come on. You can't live this thing on your own and expect to come through. Oh, come on, y'all, and hear me. Expect to come through thriving and successful. It ain't happening. You got to go through the shepherd. You got to let the shepherd guide you. You got to let, you got to let the shepherd direct your path. And the only way you can have true success is when the shepherd brings you into it. Billionaires take their life because they ain't got no shepherd. You chasing a resource. Resources will kill you if you let it be your God. You need a source. And the more you have a source, they give you resources. And I can have resources in rest. Come on, y'all with me? Yes. Glory to God. I wouldn't dare want to live this life without God. I wouldn't dare want to live this life without God. Because I've been enlightened in the truth. Everything outside of God is falsehood. Oh, Jesus. Come on, say it's falsehood. It's one of those things called a mirage. It's a thing that appears good and appears well and appears like it's the right reality, but it's not. It's just a prop. It's a set. It's a place where you become an actor. So any lifestyle outside of God is an acting lifestyle. You become a life actor. You already got your own movie going. You got that role. You play it every day. Jesus. Say, I play that role every day when I live outside of God. You ain't got to audition. It's already your role. See, in God, I walk in the light. That means I can take off every mask. Come on. That means I don't have to act. I just be Him in me. Come on. I can live out my real expression of who He is in me and who I am in Him. Glory, y'all ain't excited enough for me this morning. I don't get it. It's all good. Hallelujah. Oh, we thank You. Listen. We don't have to have revival just to have revival. You are an epitome of what revival is. Because if you don't keep yourself revived, then ain't no service gonna do it for you.
Yeah.
I wrote a post about those who are really on fire, those who are faking fire. There are many faking fire because there's no transformation. If you ain't getting transformed, you don't have real fire. Oh my God, y'all ain't hearing me. So many of us want to have a service for fire, but then you're not walking in daily fire. See, what happens is if we walk in daily fire, when we come together as fires, things can explode. But when you allow life to take you down a place where you stay distracted, you can't stir yourself up. And when you don't stay stirred, you expect the service to stir you up. Oh my God. And honestly, assembly is not meant for you to come and get. It's actually meant for you to come to be a supplier. You're supposed to come and feed into what's going on. Woo!
Yep.
I don't hear this stuff, man. Because we go through religious motions of saying, I'm going to church to get. But I never come stirred to say, I'm going to give my supply. I can't say I'm going to give my supply if I ain't stirred. So stop making church a thing that can stir you. Come on. Make your daily lifestyle with the Holy Ghost a thing that can stir you. And then when you come and assemble with the church, hallelujah, now you are a stirrer. And other people stir too. And we got our old pool of Bethesda going, where the waters are being stirred by angels now. And no man got to touch you, now you get healed while the waters are being stirred. You be like that man. Yeah, most folk like that man that Jesus had to come to and ask him, "Do you even want to be well?"
Yeah.
That's how most of us in church are. Do you even want to be well? And he's, the man still had an excuse. Well, I ain't got nobody to put me in the waters. Why do you need somebody to put you in the waters when God has already given you waters in your belly? All you got to do is stir up what he already placed on the inside. Ain't nobody got to take you into the waters. You are already in the waters. So we go from church to church and conference to conference looking for somebody to stir. Well, you need to be the stirrer. I gotta get a word. I need this. No. You need to be stirred in your secret place. Make your secret place a fireplace and you won't have to go everywhere to get something. My God, today. And don't get me wrong, I love revival. I love the movements of the Spirit. I love it. But I love it even more when people are actually stirred and ready to receive from God. Most of the times you have to get past these brick walls just to get people to receive. My God. Listen, when I pray for people, I can tell when that person is not receiving. And it's like a brick wall that you feel. And you don't even understand, the power don't go in you, it comes back to me.
That's right.
So I'm not going to take time to labor with nobody that ain't going to receive. If you're not going to receive, I'm moving on. Hallelujah. That's just how it is, because your unbelief blocks miracles. Unbelief blocks the supernatural from being deposited into you, because it's a deposit that you need for a spiritual life. But most of the time, people don't receive, they're closed. And when you're like that, I'm just not taking my time. It's just a waste of time. For me and you. So, amen. So we got to learn how to be open. We got to learn how to be sensitive. We got to learn that God wants to pour into us and get out of us what's poured in. Freely you have received. Freely you give. But you can't give if you don't receive. Receiving is the first part. Hallelujah. So most of the time I'll take some time with somebody that I know is receiving, because they're pulling. Once they're pulling, there's more rivers that are flowing out of me going into them. But then I can tell when the supply gets shut down. So I move on, because it's not worth my time. It's not worth yours either, because you ain't receiving nothing. Hallelujah. Glory. Because the more you open, the more you can be poured in. It's just like Elijah dealt with the woman that kept getting the vessels. The vessels had to be open for it to be poured into more.
Come on.
Yeah. But if the vessels were never open, you couldn't get them in the closed vessel. Woo! So I can't get nothing in a closed vessel. Anyway, hallelujah. God is good, y'all. He's a good God.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. a lot of distractions going on, but hey, you push past them. That's what we, hey, listen, life give you distractions. Life throws curveballs you ain't seen. And sometimes it's a strike, sometimes you hit the curveballs. But at the end of the day, they coming. So you got to be prepared for curveballs wherever you go. Everything is not going to go according to your plans. You got to know how to maneuver past distractions.
Come on.
Come on, y'all ain't with me. That's why he said, keep your mind stayed on me and I'll keep you in perfect peace. Many times our minds go to the distractions and not the perfect one. So there's no perfect peace. There's only chaos because distractions pull us into them. Come on. Woo! Jesus! Say distractions pull us into them at times. But we got to learn how to navigate in the midst of distractions. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Anyway, whatever. Let's talk. We want to pray for those who are sick in their bodies today too. If you're sick in your body, we want to make sure that we pray for you. But the Bible tells us to heal the sick.
Amen.
Come on, you say I'm a delegate.
Amen.
I'm delegated to heal the sick.
Amen.
Are you a born again believer? The Bible tells you that you who believe lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. That it didn't say if. It say shall. Come on, y'all. So shall is a guarantee. Anyway, we've been talking about being spirit people. Say spirit people. The Bible says that those who are born of the Spirit, what are they? Huh? Well, yeah, they that too. They're spirit. Because it said those that are born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is what?
Spirit.
So if you're born of the Spirit, what are you?
Spirit.
What are you?
Spirit.
Hallelujah. So you said, I'm just repeating for those who haven't been listening to the messages or hearing the messages or you forgot or whatever. I don't care, you know, whatever. Hallelujah. So you are a tripart being. Say tripart being.
Tripart.
What am I? A tripart being. First of all, I'm a spirit. And I have a soul. And I live in a what? I am a spirit that has a soul and that lives in a body. I am a spirit that has a soul and lives in a body. But when Adam fell and I was birthed into the earth realm through the lineage of Adam, my spirit man was dead. So I wasn't spirit then, I was flesh.
Flesh.
Say I was flesh.
I was flesh.
So at that point, I was flesh that had a soul and lived with a dying spirit. Oh Jesus, y'all ain't hearing me yet.
Jesus.
So the spirit was, which is really the real you. He was disconnected from God, disconnected from the life of God, disconnected from the presence of God, right? So at that point, soul and flesh ran everything. Say soul and flesh.
Soul and flesh.
Got together.
To run you.
Because the spirit man had no say so. Watch this. The spirit man had feelings because it's a man. But it had no say-so because it didn't have power to run things. So it wasn't allowed to be a king no more. Oh, Jesus, I'm talking to Saturday. Say it wasn't allowed to be a king no more. So when Christ came to live in you, now it awakened your spirit man, which is the real you. The real you came alive. Say the real me came alive. Now the king me is alive. Say, I'm a king. The Bible said that he has made us priests and kings unto our Father. That ain't dealing with your flesh. That's dealing with your spirit. Your spirit is a priest. And your spirit is a king.
Come on.
Say, my spirit man is a priest. And our spirit man is a king. As a priest, I'm able to function as ministry unto the Lord. And as a king, I'm able to function as ministry unto people. There's two governments that happen. I govern a life in heaven, and I govern a life on the earth. Say it's the way of the cross. The connection of the cross brought you back to spirit man connection. Man, it's quiet. Wow. Y'all with me here?
Yeah.
So, with that being said, life cannot be governed if I don't function as spirit. I'm talking this side. We're just quiet today. When we are not aware that we function as spirits, we cannot properly govern in life. God never put you on the planet to be solely human. So that means as a human, oh God, y'all ain't hear me here. As a human, if I function only in that proper protocol, then I only function in a lower dimension. Because now I only become limited to earthly activities. Earthly functionalities. Earthly operations. Come on, y'all. That's why he said, I seek such worshipers. Those that will worship me in what?
Spirit.
You can't worship God without your spirit, man. So what happens is the church has, we come into religious routines because we're trying to worship God in our flesh. And it ain't working. It ain't producing that. Come on, y'all. So God said, you got to learn how to function or worship. Worship deals with service unto the Lord.
Yes.
Come on. He said, so he's saying, your service unto me need to be in spirit.
Yes.
This is the difference between Martha and Mary. Martha was working out of fleshly administrations. Because she was trying to feed Jesus' outward man. You ain't hear me here. But Jesus was trying to tell Martha, this moment right here ain't about my outward man. This moment right here is for heaven to feed me so I can feed other people. This is why Mary chose the good part. It was good to heaven, so it was good in the eyes of Jesus, because she sat at the feet of Jesus and fed her spirit man.
Hello.
Oh boy, we have a long morning of plowing today. Hallelujah. Y'all hear me?
Yeah.
He said she chose the good part. What does that mean? She chose the part that was actually beneficial. It actually benefited her. Because she's receiving from a realm that feeds the real her. Now, serving in your flesh, you know, it's a good administration because we need it, right?
Right.
We need it, right? Because a lot of things can't happen properly if we don't serve administratively, right? But you got to recognize the moments. Oh, Jesus. You got to recognize your day of visitation. You got to recognize the moments when the Holy Spirit want to interrupt your schedule. Most of the time, we don't even recognize those moments, and we keep going through fleshly administration. Y'all ain't hear me? Because we're so focused on getting things done in the flesh, God is saying, let me interrupt you right now. Why? Because once I interrupt you, I'll give you wisdom to get it done faster. You don't understand that your accelerates process. Say, my time with God accelerates process. So you go, you gotta make your, I said it earlier, you got to make your secret place a fireplace. You gotta burn in secret. Why? Because fire opens up a government. And I ain't talking about natural government. I'm talking about a government from the spirit realm. You got to understand, every person who flowed in fire in the Bible encountered fire first. Moses encountered a private bush. It opened up a government. Now he's able to rule 40 more years. His physicality, his flesh man said, hey. His spirit man said, I'm alive. Ministry at 80 because I ain't functioning from outward man. Yeah. Oh my God, y'all ain't. Some of y'all think y'all too old to work for God, but you got to understand the fire of God keeps the government open no matter what age you are. It'll move you into movement. Come on. Fire always moves you into movement. Keeps you fresh. Keeps you energized. I don't mess with Prophet Bennett. Last week, Prophet Bennett, we're not talking about her age right now, hallelujah. But she's still young, right?
Right.
Prophet Bennett on the chairs, laying hands and stripping off devils. And come on, y'all ain't hear me here. And she got that going, hallelujah, y'all ain't hear me. Why? Because her spirit man was alive. It wasn't about her physical body. Because if you always pay attention to your physical body always have frailties. It always want to limit you to keep you in that dimension. Why? Even Moses had an excuse. But God had a plan. He had a solution. Don't you even worry about speaking. He said, I got a stutter, God. You trying to tell that to God who made you. See, God didn't make the stutter, God made Moses. Sin made the stutter. So he said, I'm going to cover your
stutter. Oh, my God.
I'm going to give you a cover. Oh, my God. You may have a speech impediment because of sin, but I know how to cover that. Don't ever pay attention to inadequacies, because you got a spirit man that, oh my God, that's energized by God. Come on, the wind of the spirit can hit your spirit. Fire of God, start opening up a new realm of grace that you never even flowed in before. Come on. Say a new realm of government, a new grace. Hallelujah. God will give you power over your stutter. God said, I tell you what, I'm going to make somebody else your prophet. You're going to be my voice, but if you're going to be your prophet, oh my God. Say, he'll give you power over your stutter. There'll be times when God will be on you. You ain't got to say a thing. You just got to be in the room. Oh my God, say, all I got to do is be in the room. What if I can't? Well, be in him and he'll take care of you. The bigness of his government comes out. The waves of glory. So don't ever predicate the call of God upon flesh. You got a whole spirit man that can direct you in your call. Because age ain't nothing but a number. Heaven doesn't pay attention to your age. Heaven is focused on the condition of your spirit man. So as a spirit, say I'm a spirit.
I'm a spirit.
As a spirit and with the Holy Spirit in us. So there's a merging, oneness, union between you and the Holy Spirit. The real you is entangled with the Holy Spirit. Say I'm entangled with the Holy Spirit. You ain't just entangled with the Holy Spirit. I'm even entangled with you.
Come on.
Oh, y'all ain't hear me. My spirit is entangled to my wife's spirit, to your spirit, everybody who's born again, our spirits are entangled. The only separation you see is on earth. That's because men can speak from men language. That's because men can move in men activities and men movements. Y'all ain't hear me. But in the spirit realm, we connected whether you like me or not. He called it mere men garbage. That's why he's talking about you carnal as flesh when you still got envy. When you're jealous of somebody else, come on. Oh, by me, cool. I catch your mind. When you have divisions among you, when you got strife among you, he said that's mere men garbage. So that means I'm talking from my outer man and not my inner man. Whatever. He said, because inner man always honors.
Yes.
Why? Because I know my alignment with you. I'm talking this side. Hallelujah. That's how I'm true. I like having fun, so y'all can get used to it. Because I know how aligned I am with you, spirit knows that. So spirit says, I will prefer you in honor before me.
Come on.
But flesh man saying, I'm jealous of what's in your belly. That's why it's a contrast between flesh and spirit. Flesh will always speak against what it's ignorant of. When I don't have a knowledge of what's in you, I will always speak against what I don't have knowledge of. Because watch this, flesh only has knowledge of what appeases itself. So I only speak against you to keep myself lifted up. Oh my God, I'm in here somewhere, huh? It ain't nothing but pride. I'll tear you down so that I can feel puffed up. Right? I don't want to pay attention to the union I got with you. Because I want to make me feel bigger than you, Ray. You know that Ray? Yeah, you know, he's a good dude, but. Anytime there's a butt, flesh involved. You know, GLC is cool, man. They got this and that, but most folk go in churches looking for flaws. I'm like, if you're going to keep coming looking for flaws, why are you still here? Because as soon as you walk through the door, the church became imperfect anyway. You got to first look at you. All right now. Come on. Why you keep going to a place you keep seeing flaws and want to call out flaws and want to tell everybody about the flaws? We got to start seeing from spirit. spirit eyes,
yes,
so we can start seeing solutions.
Yes.
You are attacking people on your team.
Yes.
How are you going to win a championship? Are you going to be successful? Keep speaking against your teammate.
Hello.
Listen, when conversations have come to you private, and they got that blood in them, and that negative, you already hear that demon talking to them, you need to go ahead and cut that to punto. Cut that off. Because that's a demon talking. And then the demon come to you privately because they don't want to be exposed. That's why it come private. Pull you aside. Call you aside. So it won't be exposed. And then you the dummy, you keep listening to it and keep it hidden. Nobody can get free if they stay hidden. And you know, don't tell the apostle. Don't tell. And I said that. That's in between me and you. Devil. It's a devil. It is. It's the devil that's trying to stay in dark operations. Trying to stay covered. You uncover it, they stop fooling with you good.
Yeah.
They will fall in devilish ways anyway. You ought to say, breath of fresh air.
Right.
Especially if they don't want deliverance. You know, one thing about the Jezebelic spirit, it's a whole person. It was a whole spirit or a whole person that took the characteristic of a human woman.
Jesus.
And she proclaimed to be a prophet. So what she want to do is always give you these side parking lot prophecies. Undercover prophecies. Another thing, she reproduces children after herself. So she does that to recruit you.
Jesus.
She recruits you to make you like herself.
Jesus.
And she do it in the dark. The Bible says she called herself a prophet. See, people like that know prophecy draw people in. They know people want to hear a word because they don't really pray. Because if you pray, you can discern a word. So they know your vulnerability is to the prophetic. They want us to hear God say it. So they come with a motive, and they come to woo you in as children. Pass down characteristics to you just like themselves. Man, you don't want to hear this, do you? I'm trying to help you. I'm trying to help somebody. They recruit. Now everybody is spiritual children.
Come on now.
And they recruit in the dark.
Oh Jesus.
Listen, let me tell you something. Let me help you today. You got people who always want to come to you privately to give you a word. And you're submitted to a local leader, a local church, or a local authority. Let me help you. They always come into you. I don't care who they are. They always come to you privately about a word. Ask them first. I'll let you give me this word, but can I submit it to authority? If can I record it and send it to authority? If you can't do that, you already know it's a motive.
Come on.
It's a motive. If you can't record it and let authority hear it, it's a motive. It's a wolf. I'm trying to help somebody.
Yep.
Because at the end of the day, when you got motives, they either trying to draw you into their camp,
yep,
or they're trying to draw you out of the camp you're supposed to be in. Come on.
Jesus.
Wow.
Woo. So that's a lesson. Please heed my God. Because if it can't be recorded anymore, authority can't hear it, that means there's something behind it that they don't want you, they don't want authority to hear, because authority can discern true motives.
Yes, sir.
Man, I thought it was quiet. Which it is, hallelujah. Anyway, let me get back to what I was saying. So as the Spirit, and with the Holy Spirit, we merge, say we merge together, one with one another. The Lord is always speaking, He's always leading, and He's always guiding. But the problem is the sensitivity on our end. It's not on God's end, it's our end. Think about radio waves. Radio waves are always waving. That's a word for you, hallelujah. They're always going, they're always transmitting, right? The frequency is the problem. What channel are you tuned into? If I want to listen to gospel music in this area, then I need to go to, what's my gospel station? 95.5, right? I got to tune into that station to hear what's being transmitted. Y'all with me?
Come on.
I can't go to 93.2 and say, I'm trying to hear the gospel, because 93.2 may be a static. And then if I go to 99.7, I'm going into the station of flesh. Come on. So what happens is all these voices are speaking. We just got to be in tune to which voice is God. The flesh has got a voice. Confusion got a voice, that's why it's called static. Jesus, y'all ain't hearing me. Demons talk to you. Come on. Your soul be talking to you. There's a lot going on. There's a lot of voices. This is why he said, test the spirits, plural. You have to test them to see, are they of God? See, is their originality from God? Is it sourced from God? How will I know if it's sourced from God if I don't spend time with God? Uh-oh, let me hit you with this. How do I even know it's God if I don't even spend time in the Word? Because, watch this. I can think I'm spending time with God and hearing a voice, and it can be a familiar voice that continues speaking to you and you think it's God. But if I don't have no word in me to discern what's familiar, oh my God, and what's God, then I can keep being duped by a voice. I'm trying to teach you in life skills. Come on, hallelujah. I'm trying to teach you how to be a spirit. I'm through with church antics and mechanics and doing all that, hallelujah. It's time for us to live as sons of God. It's time for us, if you're going to be, you talking about you're a son of God, that means I'm a spirit man. Come on, y'all with me. That means my father, so he's always leading, he's always guiding. The problem is sensitivity on our end. The problem is to recognize when we don't recognize when he speaks, but it's like, how does he speak? Y'all with me? So it's like, it's not when he speaks, he's always speaking. It's how is he speaking? It's what's the way he's speaking? Tune it in. My spirit man has spiritual antennas that connect to a heavenly world, right? So if my antennas are not in the right place, I miss the tune. I miss the channel he's speaking from. Y'all with me? When we don't hear God, it doesn't necessarily mean that he's silent. It means that we are distracted. That's the difference. Jesus was so fine-tuned with the Father that he had unrestricted fellowship. He said, I only do what I see my Father do. Everything we saw him do in 3.5 years was directed by the Father. Why? Because he stayed in tune. Jesus said, I'm your example. Now, none of us have cultivated to a place yet, say yet, where we got uninterrupted fellowship. Not yet. But Jesus said he's the perfect model for you to follow. So it's like, what did he do to stay connected? Many times we do what religious past experiences teach us. So we stay in a pattern of doing religious things but getting no fruit. No results. No transformation. Come on, y'all with me. So, Jesus is saying, I'm always speaking, but you're distracted. So we got to learn how to be less distracted so we can hear more. So we can know more. Because a lot of our hearing is not me waiting on a voice. It's me recognizing a knowing. That's why you are a spirit man. Many times we don't move on stuff because we ain't heard God. But God already put it in your knower. You already know it, you're just not discerning the knower. Jesus. I want to hear from God. God said, I'm always talking to you. How are you positioned? How is your heart or spirit posture?
Yeah, yeah.
We ignore God more than we hear God.
Yeah.
Well, how do I know about this relationship? God told you when you first met him. He already told you. You just ignored him. And now you're in a situation it's hard to get out of. Because you're ignoring him when he first told you. My Lord. Those who are in tune with the Holy Spirit, they make wise choices. Their life is more stable. You ain't gonna ever be without trouble.
That's right.
Troubles is because you're in the world, the Bible says.
Right?
So you gonna go through stuff. That's just what it is. The problem is, what am I hearing and doing while I'm going through?
Come on.
What is the condition of my spirit man while I'm going through?
Yeah.
Am I keeping it strengthened or am I letting external stuff weaken it?
Come on, Jesus. Yes. Come on.
Say he's always speaking.
I'm
going to prove to you, Matthew 4:4. Jesus himself said this. He said, it is written, man, shall not what?
Live.
Not what?
Bread.
So bread deals with the natural consumption. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Don't you daily consume stuff naturally?
Mm-hmm.
He said, you ain't going to live from that dimension alone. But this is how you're going to live. By what?
Every
word. By what?
Every word.
By what?
Every word.
That proceeds from the mouth of God. He said, we shall live by it. Ain't you living every day?
Yeah.
if I'm not living every day, then somewhere I'm dead. Right? Because if you stop for a while, if you stop eating natural consumption, your body should die. Oh my God.
Come on.
This is why people that are in the church who ignore God, can't not in tune with God, because I ain't gonna say you can't hear God, because you can't. You just ignore God. You ain't in tune with God. You refuse to obey God. Come on, y'all, they hear me? When people are like that, they're not living. They're just existing. Their soul and body is still moving, but their spirit man is not functioning. So they're just existing. They're just living life with every external thing that comes my way. Everything that comes my way, I'm going to take it. That's my opportunity. Listen. The more you keep living from a life with no prayer, eventually you'll come upon an association that's demonic. You'll come upon situations that's demonic, because you're not able to discern what's God and what's not. So every opportunity, because you're not in tune, every opportunity comes to you, you take it. Eventually, you're going to be the devil's mouthpiece. Woo! Anyway, y'all just looking at me funny right here. I'm being real, because the enemy is a spirit. So you can't see him. You have to discern him. Right? So what he would do is come in a form that you like. A form that you're tempted by. A form that's familiar. The crazy thing is, the enemy has been studying you for so long, he knows what's familiar to you. So he'll send a familiar package in a different form. But it's familiar. It's just a different form. Oh my God. Anyway. Whatever. So we should live by every word. The word is rhema. Rhema is divine utterance from a present and living voice. A right now word. So God is always giving out right now words for you. Oh my God. Hallelujah. Say, so he's always giving out right now words for me. You ain't got to search your prophet out. You got right now words once you read the word and God's voice comes on the scripture. The word proceeds means ongoing, endless, infinite action. So God has endless words for you. That's why the thoughts towards you, they never end. See, thoughts come out your mouth. Oh my God, y'all ain't hearing me. So his thoughts toward you, they never end. Thoughts of peace and not of evil. They never end. But if I don't get in tune, I won't recognize these thoughts. I hope I'm teaching somebody. Hallelujah. Say, I got to recognize them thoughts. When it comes to his voice, it's always giving me something right now. That's why the Bible says, it's daily bread.
Yes, sir.
He's trying to tell you, he speaks so regular, it becomes your daily bread. Yeah. Just like you regularly eat. He said, I speak just as regular as you eat.
Yeah.
Now thank God speaks as much as he breathes.
Yeah.
How is the word not going to talk?
Come on here. Jesus.
You got the Holy Spirit in you. Why he ain't talking to you?
Come on now.
I'm just asking. If he in you, why wouldn't the one in you not talk to you? See, he's feeding your spirit man. He said, I'm the living bread that feeds your spirit man. I'm not trying to feed your flesh. Your spirit man is what I care about. He said, you need fleshly food to stay alive on the earth. So you can remain my earth suit. But you need spiritual food to be a son that can activate while you're on the earth. You need to feed your spirit man so you can be one that makes a difference.
Yeah.
Most of us can't make a difference because we're weak in spirit. We need strength in our spirits. We need, because the more strength you get in your spirit, the more the burning in you increases. Have you ever felt, Prophet Bennett, have you ever felt dry prayer?
Yep.
And have you felt fire prayer?
Yep.
Wasn't it a big difference?
Yes,
oh my God. Fire always makes a difference.
Yes, yes.
So if my prayers are dry, where's my fire?
Jesus.
If my life is dry, where's my fire? If my worship is dry, where's my fire? Uh-oh, if my capacity for the word is dry, where's my fire? See, most people are used to an hour and 30 minutes of church. I need 2 hours. That's what they're used to. So after this certain period, they start shutting down in the flesh. Because I'm used to, my body was acclimated to this certain length. Listen, most of the time when you in prayer for that long, you ain't broke into nothing yet. How you expect church to be that long and break into something? You ain't. You still in the outer court. Oh, we had a good church today. Oh, okay, did you? What kind of shift you had in your life? Have you been empowered today?
Yeah,
I was motivated. Yeah. Your spirit man wasn't built up, though. Listen, 2 hours should just be your time praying in tongues. 2 hours should be the time you spend in the word by yourself. You tell me the whole service. How you gonna feed the hungry in 2 hours?
Jesus.
And another thing is, what we love is, and this is how I can tell we're more religious than spiritual. We love motion in the flesh. So if it's motion in the flesh, then I'm entertained enough to stay awake. I'm entertained enough for you to keep my attention when I got motion in the flesh going. But when it's time to your spirit man to actually receive so it can be built, we shut down. Because this ain't about outward stuff. This goes spirit to spirit.
Come on. Wake up.
Jesus.
Woo!
Jesus.
Yeah, Lord. But if you are building yourself up daily in the Word, you ain't got a problem in the Lord. Yeah, hi. Come on, feed me some more. Yeah. Like, feed me, Seymour. Come on. You remember that? Let's go. Seymour, feed me. Feed me some more. That's what your spirit man like. I ain't do yet. But oh, we had good church. Oh, I ain't do. I'm still feeding. You done gave me a 15-minute, 3-point sermon, and you expect me to be full? You done shouted, you done hollered, but now it's time to build you up. So we be in our own world. We think about everything else but the Word. I can see them both. Food. Boyfriend. Girlfriend. Facebook. Who I'm on text. I can't wait to get home so I can play with this. I can play with that. I can do this what I need to do. Every other thought but the Word. That's why he had to get your tongues to bypass all that.
Yes.
So you can actually build up your spirit without getting distracted.
Yes.
See, you only get distracted when there is English or whatever language you speak. You can get really distracted. Why? Because it's coming from a place where you understand. Anytime there's understanding, there can be distractions. Mm-hmm. What you don't understand is what can bypass.
Come on,
Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder what sentence is doing. Mm-hmm. Boop, 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 boop. So we don't exercise being spiritual beings. We just become churched. I love listening to the Word. That's why I love giving it, because I love listening. I love the Word.
Right.
Whatever. So your human body was created to work with the atmosphere and the environment of the earth, which also tells me my spirit man was designed to work with the atmosphere and the environment of the spirit world. I have been designed to function within heavenly places and from heavenly places.
Come on,
y'all ain't with me.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit wants to shift us into spirit consciousness, meaning spirit awareness.
Yes.
That's what Paul was saying in Colossians. Now let's go there, hallelujah, because I don't know. I'm going to explain to you. This is Paul, and so y'all will believe me. Colossians 3:1. He said, if you were raised with Christ. How many of you in here raised with Christ?
Amen.
Are you raised with Christ in him?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Who was raised? Who was raised? Your spirit man. Because your flesh died in the grave.
Right.
And you left it there.
Left it.
The old man dead. Your spirit man rose. Say my spirit man rose.
My spirit.
All right. Since my spirit man rose, I'm a spirit. So since your spirit, he says, spirit, seek those things which are from where you're born from.
Come on, spirit.
Come on. Come on.
Come on.
Say, I'm born from above.
I'm born from above.
So I got to seek my home.
Come on.
I got to seek the things from my house.
Come on.
See, in the flesh, you're here at church, but you're always seeking to go back home. Why we don't do that in the spirit?
Jesus.
There are things at home, spirit. right hand of God. Oh, I wanted to show this example real quick. Let me get some chairs right here. I just need two chairs. Help me out. I want to show you something. See, if it was saying this, they would be that thing. Hello? Sit there, right there, 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 there. All right, so, when they're going to use you, you're going to be right hand. No. Hello? Come here, y'all. Well, yeah, you come. You want to raise his hand? Never mind, sir. He worried, he raised his hand. Man, man, both of y'all come. Come on, both of y'all come. I'm going to give you both of y'all. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Charles, you see it. Man of God, you stand up. Right. Just turn it toward the people right there. Yeah, yeah, right there. Hallelujah. Now, in the heavens, right now, this is the Father. You with me? Christ is at his right hand. They're seated together. Right? Where's the Holy Spirit? In the earth, in you working. This is the Holy Spirit. He's working in you, and he's working in the earth. Come on, come on. Because he's in you. Come here, Roshan. Because he's in you. It was a divine exchange. He got in you. This is you. This is representing the whole body of Christ. He is in you. But this is the transaction that helped happen in heaven. Go sit in your name for that. We are seated with him. Don't get no idea with it. Hallelujah. We are. See, it's inside of your human body, the Holy Spirit is working. But you, matter of fact, you here and there. But in the heavenlies, sitting at the right hand, you're seated with him. The whole church is in the lap of Jesus. This is the bride of the bridegroom. This is the husband, and this is the wife. That's why the Bible is, Bible said the church is a her. He washes her with the word. So we're all connected to this seat. Think about where you pray from now. Think about where you live from now. The Holy Spirit is to make sure this is happening in your life. Oh my God. The Holy Spirit knows every movement that's here, so he tries to teach it to you here. You gotta listen to him daily. He's always speaking. He's trying to tell you how to function from that reality.
Jesus.
Because the Father in there. See, they're all this, you see all this connection? Plus this connection. There's no separation. So what he's thinking, he's already speaking. What he's thinking, he's speaking. And you're sitting with it. So how can't you hear? How can't you hear? Don't lick your lip. Well, that is your mind. You do it. But not in it. Not up in it. We like to have fun here, y'all. Hallelujah. But how can't you hear the one that's speaking? He right here in your ear. Oh, Thank y'all so much. I just wanted to show that. She's like, oh, get up there. If you got up there, honeymoon, my love. We got to keep jostling for you, hallelujah. Jesus. So you get what I'm saying? So where Christ is, you are. Thank you, Steve. You and Christ are at the right hand.
Yes.
That's your position. That's where you're seated.
Yes.
And the Holy Spirit makes that evident.
Yes.
That's why he bears witness, his testimony, his proof that where I'm seated, I already know.
Amen.
So I function from that reality. Stop begging God.
Jesus.
You his wife.
Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. You're a wife and a son at the same time.
Mm.
You got a bed. You got rights. Legal rights.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh God, please. And go back to what's not normal.
Come on.
Well, what he was crushed with, you're going to go back to. That's because you're selfish. You want to please you. You're participating in what Jesus was crushed with so you can be free from it.
Come on.
What else? Who is quiet? Well, we're all sinners. I ain't.
Come on. Come on.
That's a lie. More Pope is proven is a lie. That's what you heard from religious thinking. Everybody's not a sinner. Why? Because he made me righteous. How can I be a sinner if he made me righteous? He became sin so that I may be righteous. We don't read the Bible. We just listen to religious preaching. Everybody said, no, they're not. You just don't understand your position in Christ. And so you live from what you think everybody do. Everybody just ain't out here saying. And I hate to bust your boat. Everybody's not doing what you choose to do. Because sin is a choice. Sin is not something that's automatic. It's a choice. Because when the Holy Spirit came to make your spirit man alive, he gave your choice back. He said, if you walk in the Spirit, so you won't fulfill the lust of your flesh. If I don't fulfill the lust of my flesh, I ain't going into sin. Hallelujah. Trying to teach yourself. Hallelujah. See, and I wrote this in the post. What we do is, we believe more in the fallen man than we do in the resurrected one. So what happens is, we believe more in that power to fall than the power to actually rise and stay rose. Oh my God. So what happens is, we make excuses for human failures. We make those excuses, and then the first time somebody say something to you about it, don't judge me. How many of you need to be judged? I would rather be judged by somebody else than take on the miseries of what the judgment produces in your life.
Come on now.
Because at the end of the day, every sin has a consequence. So I would rather somebody say, hey, you gotta stop that. Call me out on that so I won't have to face consequences. But we get so proud of everybody wants to ugly. That's because you don't want to stay clean. If you love holiness, you don't mind being judged. Because at the end of the day, if I'm getting it wrong, I'm going to turn. I'm going to get it right. Come on. I ain't going to make no excuse. Oh, yeah, you're right. You're right. Your attitude was funky today. Yeah, you're right. I'm sorry.
Jesus.
Look at your face. What did I do? Oh, you just out there got a stank face. You were born with a stank face. Folks ain't delivered in their faces. Say the face, baby. We need deliverance in faces. Hallelujah. But you can change. You can change. Hallelujah. See, I can change. Folks that don't want to change, that's the problem. That is the problem. But people who are, the Bible said, pursue holiness. People who pursue holiness, they don't mind being called out if need be. Because they want to stay clean. Right? If I'm pursuing being clean, then please help me to be clean.
Yes.
You should want help being clean. Anyway, let me get back. Hallelujah. Again, we got to stop begging God. Hallelujah. Say, stop begging God. The Bible, the Bible, the Bible, the Bible, the Bible declares. In Romans 12 and 2, he said, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed. I mean, I gotta take on another form. That means I got the capability to change. That means I ain't got to stay the same. How do I change though? What? Renewing means continual renewal. That means I can't just change it today and tomorrow go back to it. A lot of people do good deeds and then they think they're right with God. You know, I did this good deed, now everything is well. But you can do a good deed, still have a trashy mind. God, more than your actions, he's more concerned with your mindset. What are you doing to change the way you think? And repentance, let me help somebody, my Lord. Repentance is not always about crying. Because you can boo-hoo and still be the same. Right? You gotta cry to repent. Everybody gotta weep. Weep right now, weep. And folks be fake weeping. Mindset still like, I'm still gonna do what I do.
Wow. Come on.
Weeping, flesh actions, no spiritual change. Most folk are in remorse that they got caught. Instead of actually repent from it. I'm sorry because I got caught. Not that I really want to change. I'm trying to help somebody. So he said, I got to renew my mind that I may prove what is the good, acceptable, perfect will of God. There's only one will. It ain't three different wills. Try to help you. We always say, oh, there's a permissive will. No, it ain't but one will. Who give you permission? I thought he was God.
Jesus. Come on, Jesus.
Oh, there's a permissive will. No, there's a will you chose and you thought God permitted it. That's your problem. Because it's a way that seems right to a person. But at the end of that way is, oh, you permitted me. God permitted me. No, he didn't. You just took that path. But anyway, he said the will of God. So basically, the will of God is good, is acceptable, and it's perfect. He's telling you, it's good. Say it's good. It's acceptable. Who's it acceptable to? Not you. It's acceptable to him. Because there's things that God make you do according to his will you don't accept. Oh my, am I right? Because you can't live it from your flesh. You got to live it from your spirit. My spirit agrees. It's only a sacrifice because your flesh don't want to do it. That's why it's called sacrifice. Because your flesh don't want to do it. So who you going to side with? So he said, the will of God is good, it's well-pleasing. That's what he said to me. It's well-pleasing to the Father. This is why he said, this is my son and whom I'm well-pleased. He's saying, this is my son, it's my will in the earth. He said, he's my living will in flesh. So he's saying, now you are in him, now you prove it. Prove the the example he set. So we don't pray prayers of begging. We prove what we pray. That's why Jesus was proving everything. He knew the will of God. How you going, oh God, beg for a will that you just need to prove? That's why he said, give tithes and offerings, prove me in it. That's some type of action in this thing. Listen, I ain't got to pray about my money. I just need to sow. You praying about what you need action for. He said, prove me. Is not from God. Right? If I know the will of God, I know sickness is not his will. Am I right? So when I deal with sickness, I'm not begging it to leave. I'm not even asking God, because I'm proving something. I command what's not his will to come out. God, please heal. Please heal, brother Betty. Please, please, please. God, like my will is a healer. Command it to come out. So when somebody is dealing with a sickness, you command the sick thing to come out of them. That's his will. You don't ask a demon to come out. You command it. Ooh. Our prayer life's got to change. God, you said this in your word. So I receive such and such, such and such. You asking for fire and God says stir yourself up. You ain't got to ask for a fire, you need to stir up. If you know it's his will, prove it. Hello? Anyway, whatever. I guess I gotta do it Tuesday night. Anyway, whatever. Let me just get you into this first part of spiritual senses, and we're gonna shift into something, because I want to make sure that people who are sick, they receive healing today. Amen?
Amen.
Say spiritual senses.
Spiritual.
The Bible says we need to exercise. Why do I need to exercise? One, because I'm not acclimated to them. Two, because they're weak. Right? Anytime you exercise, that means you're not used to the muscular activity that you're trying to get to. Right? So you're trying to build to get to a certain place. Right? That means I'm weak and not strong enough. So you gotta exercise, right? So I gotta exercise to get acclimated to a world I'm not used to.
Come on.
So it means I gotta get acclimated in my spiritual, say spiritual sight.
Spiritual sight.
Spiritual taste.
Spiritual taste.
Spiritual hearing.
Spiritual hearing.
Spiritual touch.
Spiritual touch.
And spiritual smell.
Spiritual smell.
Jesus.
Now there's more sensitivities that I'm going to introduce, but these are just, I'm just matching the human part of you. The human part of you from babyhood on up, you had to exercise. You had to actually use those different things to actually become familiar with it, right? So in order for me to actually be able to live from a heavenly place, I got to exercise my spiritual senses so I can recognize that place when it shows up. Right?
Yeah. Come on.
Amen.
If I'm not sensitive, I won't recognize where God is moving.
Yes, sir.
How he was. Anyway. Say spiritual senses.
Yes.
Always remember this. All of our spiritual senses are interwoven together like a cluster. Say, like a cluster. What does that mean? It means that they can all function together at the same time if need be. And this is why many times you will see multiple senses happening at the same time.
Woo!
Come on.
Man, somebody excited.
Yes.
All right, for instance, sometimes you can see and hear.
Yeah.
Sometimes you can taste and smell.
Yeah.
Sometimes you can touch and then see.
Yeah.
Touch and then hear. Come on.
Yeah, right.
Whatever. Anyway. I hope I'm helping somebody.
Yeah.
Say Mark 2 and 8.
Wow.
Immediately when Jesus perceived in his spirit. That's not the Holy Spirit. That's his spirit. And it says he was perceiving in the Holy Spirit. He perceived in his spirit. Why? Because Jesus exercised that part of him. Why do you think he spent 30 years? Growing, the Bible said he became strong in spirit. So Jesus was strengthened in his spirit. Now his spirit can recognize other spirits.
Yes, sir.
Other spiritual activities. Other spiritual movements and operations. Woo! That's good teaching, whether you say so or not. I don't care.
It's good.
What did he perceive in his spirit, Xavier? That the people reason within themselves. So Rochelle, what he did was, he picked up in his spirit that was reasoning in their spirits. The reasoning going on in their spirits, he picked it up. What does perceive mean? To become aware through senses. He sensed them reasoning in their spirit.
Yes.
Oh my God.
Good. That's good.
Watch this, y'all. Woo, this is good. He said, why do you reason about these things in your hearts? The word heart here is epignosis. Say epignosis.
Epignosis
means heart-to-heart knowledge. To know firsthand. Oh, come on, y'all ain't hear me. To know is if you had direct contact, or is if it was a direct conversation you had with the people. To know on a heart or thought pattern level. You ain't hear me. So watch this. In his spirit, you gotta understand, your spirit got a mind. So your spirit got thoughts. So his thoughts picked up their thoughts. This is how good it was, Rochelle. My top of hope,
thank you, Jesus.
So they reasoned within themselves. So I mean, they didn't verbally talk about it. They was talking to themselves about it. So they had a themself conversation. Right? So this is how much he perceived it. As if they were saying to Jesus,
right there in his feet.
As if they were directly talking to Jesus, ear to ear. That's how much he perceived them talking to themselves. In his spirit, he heard a whole conversation. He heard that dishonor. So you gotta understand, God will give you the ability to hear thoughts. This is why God has given the ability to me to preach about what you're presently thinking or dealing with. Because it's the same spirit connection. I told you we connected spirit to spirit.
Nah.
Oh, Jesus. So Jesus was able to hear a whole conversation in his spirit. He heard what they were talking about. And then he said, why y'all reasoning among each other? They couldn't deny it. Because they just were speaking to themselves about what he just did. That's how you catch a liar.
Come on.
When you become sensitive in your spirit, liars can't get away. Manipulators can't get away. Deceivers can't deceive you. But when you're not in tune, you get bamboozled. You're a huckster in the flesh. I'll be your hook up in other men. Think about this, y'all. In the natural, when we can't see or hear in the natural, we're labeled as disabled. That person has a hearing disability, seeing disability. So why should it be acceptable for sons of God to not spiritually see and hear? That means in the spirit realm, you're disabled. There's many in the church that are sight disabled and hearing disabled. But you can activate your ability by exercising your senses. You know why, Vanessa, you come in the room and then you start picking up why they talking about you? But then they scatter like they ain't saying that. And they scatter like roaches. You already knew they were saying something about you. You already picked it up. Your spirit was already warning you. See, believe what your spirit picked up. Stop ignoring what your spirit picked up. Yeah, they cheating on you because your spirit picked it up. Yeah, they snakes and talking about you because your spirit picked it up. And most of the time we try to ignore it. Oh, they don't do me like that. Oh, yeah, they will. I put nothing past a carnal joker. If you ain't spiritual, I put nothing past you. But I can't believe it. I can. His mind wasn't renewed. Her mind wasn't renewed. I can understand it. When your mind ain't renewed, you'll commit murder. You'll lie, you'll steal, you'll do all this stuff when your mind ain't renewed. I can believe if you cuss somebody out because your mind ain't been renewed.
Help us.
You're right.
Jesus. I can't believe it. To me, I can't. Because yes, while he been good to you, he ain't been renewing his mind. So his mind are on things of the flesh, even though having a form to be good to you. So he want his cake and eat it too. See, he don't want you to leave, or she don't want you to leave, but yet they want more than you. Because anything that's carnal wants more. It's never satisfied with what it got because it won't discipline itself. Oh my God. It's an ungoverned flesh. And it always gonna want more. You know what we say, I'm evident about it. You know what we say? I'm just gonna eat one scoop. Then we get another scoop. I want more. We eat it because it's good, not because we're hungry.
Come on, come on, come on.
Jesus.
It never satisfies us. If it's raining my flesh, it's going to always want more than you. Woo! Like, why she cheat on me, man? Hey, she fleshly. She governed my own flesh. You going to stay with it? So it's a non-satisfying sinful flesh that loves to be satisfied when it's satisfied, but it's never satisfied. So it'll always be satisfied temporarily, but then it wants some more. That's why fasting is so important. Say, fasting is so important.
Fasting is so important.
Let me give you this about what I wrote about fasting real quick. The biblical definition of fasting is to deny ourselves food for the sake of seeking God. I know we got all these other things we try to deny, but that ain't your problem. Your problem is that your God has become your belly.
Jesus.
The more you feed your belly, the more your flesh strengthens. So social media ain't the problem. It's your belly the problem.
Come on, Bill.
TV ain't the problem. Your belly.
Come on now.
Hallelujah. But notice it said fasting and prayer. Because fasting alone is just a diet. You ain't praying, it's just a diet. I'm just losing weight. Hallelujah. Fasting shuts down and weakens the part of us that wants to seek out the wrong way. In order for us to seek God for the right way. So fasting cuts off the supply of energy to the flesh and weakens our flesh and makes us sensitive for spiritual realities. But again, fasting and prayer. Fasting does one part. There's another part.
This
side. Fasting is just one part. There's another part.
Yeah.
And prayer.
And prayer.
So when fasting weakens your flesh, prayer strengthens us, builds us, and supplies us the supernatural energy in your spirit, man, to pursue spiritual things.
Amen.
So you're not praying with your fasting, you still ain't accomplishing anything. The reason I'm fasting is because I want to see God.
Yeah.
Come on.
Amen.
Whatever. Come on. Right, gain weight in the spirit, that right there. We want spiritual weight.
Yeah.
Woo! It's quiet, quiet, quiet.
Yeah.
Say spiritual weight.
Spiritual weight.
Say, I got to trust my spirit.
I got to trust my spirit.
See, I told you, your spirit following that inner witness, that's the only thing the devil cannot duplicate. Because he's not connected to your spirit, man. Only God is. That's where God occupies you. You can never be possessed in your spirit. You're only oppressed. And you're only depressed. And you're demonized in your soul, in your body. Your spirit, man, the Holy Spirit and him are one. Holy Spirit has greater power. How can devils be in your spirit, man? If the Holy Spirit be your spirit, man.
Yeah.
Hello? So anyway, hallelujah. So God is saying you can trust your inner witness. Trust what you perceive in your spirit. You can be duped in your mind. Because your mind, you know how the mind playing tricks on. It can really play tricks on.
Yeah.
But here, when you pick it up here, go with that.
Yeah.
Don't neglect that.
Right.
If there's a lack of peace, go with it. Like, it's a turning, it's a, you need to go with it. Y'all with me?
Amen.
So real quick, say my, I gotta have spiritual sight. This is why you gotta be able to see in the spirit. You don't wanna be what we would call blind. That's a disability, right? Come on, y'all with me?
Yes.
The Bible talks about the man who Jesus was giving the man. It was the rich man, right? And it was Lazarus. Lazarus was a poor beggar. The rich man totally ignored him, right? Both of them died. Both of them went to hell. Y'all with me? Both of them went to hell. It was a two parts to hell. It was an Abraham's bosom hell. And it was a hell.
Come on now.
Because Jesus opened the way for heaven.
My Lord.
Y'all hear me? Nobody had the ability before Jesus to live in heaven except whoever God want to take up. People like Enoch and Elijah, he took them, right? But as far as people dying and going, no, they went into Abraham's bosom. This is why Jesus went into the belly of the earth to get the keys from Satan and to pull up those that was in Abraham's bosom. They had to resurrect with him. Why Jesus went to the belly of the earth? He went to hell first. He had to preach to the spirits that were in prison. They broke them up with him, and they rose. Their bodies came out the grave. They come walking. They ain't come out like the zombies. They ain't do that. They walk as glorified beings because they walk like him. And he spent 40 days as a glorified being with that company with him. They walking around Jerusalem. Oh my God. Abraham walking around to Jerusalem. Y'all ain't hearing me here. Come on. All the folk that died righteous in Christ, they were walking around Jerusalem. That was the first resurrection. But there's another coming. So Jesus is returning. He's coming back. Come on. Ain't he coming back? That's my hope. He's coming back. I want to be here to see that. What that is going to be like? It's going to be glorious. Because the dead in Christ going to rise first. And then us, the Bible said, we change in a moment. Soon as they said that big, you know, twinkle like a little ping. Soon it's going to ping. Have his body like my colossiva. Going to have that both glorified body. What? Deep go, hallelujah. Gonna have a beautiful body, baby. Cause he gotta come back and it's like this. I got to just as your spirit man was brought alive. The body that we have is the body Adam gave us. So I got to get rid of what Adam gave you to give you what the last Adam got.
Come on.
That's why you need a new body. So you're no longer connected at all to the first Adam. That's why now you hurt and you be in pain and you be walking funny and you're getting older because it's the first body. It came from the first Adam. But you got another body. It never get tired. It never get weak. It never get sick. Hallelujah. It can walk through walls.
Hallelujah.
It can think a thing and be there.
Yes.
Oh, Jesus. I want that body. Come on, y'all. But I want to exercise my spirit, man, now.
Yes.
To where I can start functioning. At least a measure of that capacity.
Yeah, I think so.
Because at the measure, Jesus was able to walk through people with his first body.
Amen.
You don't want to hear that type of stuff right there. Jesus was able to walk on water with his first body.
Yeah.
That's right. What's wrong with you? Is it in your belly? Hallelujah. So in this place, Lazarus was in hell being tormented. And the Bible says he lifted his eyes, but he don't got his body. What is his eyes? It's his spirit eyes. Because his spirit man got eyes. And his spirit eyes saw Abraham afar off in Abraham's bosom. It was a separation between hells. One was a holding place, the other was torment. And then Jesus came and he brought to the place where Abraham's bosom, everybody in that bosom was taken up. Now they can't view that no more. Close that. He closed that gap up. Oh God. Ain't that good? So he saw him afar off, and Lazarus was in Abraham's bosom. So the first function that is awakened when your spirit man is awakened is your sight. Say my sight. It's my John 3:3 says, unless you are born again or born from above, you cannot see the kingdom of God. Sight dimension is open. But why the church is not seeing? Because they have been religiotized. Because religion is scales on your eyes. Why do you think Paul had to have hands laid on his eyes? Because Paul was zealously under the religious order, right? When Jesus came and gave him a revelation of who he was, because Paul had religious eyes, scales came up. What are scales? Serpents' coverings. And blind. So the serpent will give you a covering to blind you from seeing what you need to see. That's what religion does. It gives you serpent scales. And so when Ananias laid hands on him, the Bible said his scales fell off. Jesus came to awaken Paul's eyes, but he couldn't see yet because he was still in religion. But once the Holy Ghost filled him, so the fruit of your born-again experience is sight. Say, sight is my fruit. Oh, Jesus, this is good teaching, man. Hallelujah. 1 John 2:11 says, he who hates his brother or sister is in darkness. And you walk in darkness. And you do not know where you're going because the darkness has blinded your eyes. What eyes? I can still see. I may hate you, but I can still see. He's trying to tell you, when you get born from above, your hatred is evidence of your blindness spiritually. Because I'm not seeing you from spiritual eyes. I'm only seeing you from eyes of the flesh. So I hate you because I'm seeing from fleshly eyes, but I can't see you spiritually.
That's right.
Blind spiritually. Hatred is spiritual blindness. That's why racism is spiritual blindness. Woo! Oh, we don't want to hear this stuff. Whoever you hate, you are blind spiritually. Because why? Love keeps your eyes open.
Come on.
Amen.
You want to know how to keep your eyes open? Love. God ain't going to show you nothing about these people, and you got blinders. Because you're going to only want to see what you want to see. So he ain't going to show you nothing. Because you choose to stay in your hatred. So you choose to see from the wrong set of eyes. Spiritual blindness will always produce spiritual barriers. Ooh, this is good teaching. Barriers are a separation between what you do not know and what you're supposed to know. Watch this. Man, it's like not knowing, it's like not knowing what spiritual dimension somebody else is in. And you thinking you're in the same dimension. When you can't see, you won't honor the dimension somebody else is in because you can't see it. So now you'll treat them as if we were in the same dimension. One of the things that have, one of the things in my own life that have got a lot of attacks against me, dishonor coming toward me, is because I'm accessible. And folk, when you become accessible, people can get so familiar they forget who you are. So now instead of treating me as if you once saw me, that you respected before, now you come to a place thinking we're in the same dimension, so I can talk to you any kind of way. Even Paul had to deal with that. Paul said once, he said once you saw me like an angel, and you saw me even as God himself. You once had that type of revelation about me that I was a delegate from above, that you treated me with honor. But now you got too big for your britches. So now you see me as your companion. Same dimension. When you don't have eyes to actually see what dimension I'm actually in. So how you treat me is in a dimension that's like yours.
Yeah.
So you talk to me in a kind of way, you treat me in a kind of way, and anything you can say, right? Because you don't understand spiritual eyes to see. Spiritual revelation will always help us recognize the reality of where we are and where someone else is in the spirit.
Amen.
Always. That was a good sign. That's why folk be disrespecting you. Because they don't see you. They talk to you. They don't honor you because they don't have honorable eyes. You need honorable eyes. But it takes a revelation to have honor. Private prayer exposes the separation of spiritual dimensions. If I don't pray, I will never know what's exposed. And it exposed the difference or the dimensions between Jesus and his inner circle of disciples. Jesus was able to navigate who needed to be where through prayer because he had eyes to see. Y'all good? He had a whole company, 70, right? Matter of fact, before we go back, multitudes. That was multitudes. He allowed them access to a certain extent, but when it was time to depart, he left them where they were. Right? Jesus, I'm trying to help somebody. Because if you navigate what people are supposed to be in your life, you won't get hurt. You trying to fit folk into your life that don't need to be there. They ain't got spiritual dimensions to even stay there. They ain't got the capacity to be your companion.
Jesus.
Why are you trying to keep them there? They ain't got the capacity. God didn't ordain that friendship. Why are you trying to make them friends?
Jesus.
Wow.
You trying to stick that square peg in a circle. It don't fit. And you be like, they're rejecting me. They're rejecting you because they can't see you. They don't know the dimension you're in, so they don't even know the dimension they own self in. So they're trying to talk to you from the dimension that they're in, and you like, man, every time they talk, you just rub the wrong way because you're in another dimension.
Jesus.
But you're still trying to keep them around.
Wow. That's good.
That's good.
Yeah.
Wow.
So you got to understand what dimension people are in so you can navigate where they need to be in your life.
That's right. That's good. That's right.
My God. So when he went in private, he took his 12. But when he went even more private, he only took 3. So that tells me I don't need no more than 3 really in a circle for
you.
Three ones that I can share my heart with. But I gotta be able to discern them.
That's right.
Can't tell everybody to come.
That's right.
And trust the wicked.
That's why Jesus said, who do men say I am? Why did he ask them that? Because he knew their conversations outside of being from among him. He knew what other folks said about him. Through his company. He said, I forget that. Who you say I am? But they were wrong anyway. They got eyes. Notice only one spoke up. Because only one got the revelation of the dimension he was in. Oh my God.
Jesus.
Spiritual sight.
Spiritual sight.
I like what Apostle Woods always said. Where there's no revelation, there's always be violation. Watch this. Let me add another one. Where there's no revelation, there'll always be degradation. Meaning I'll always degrade you. Private prayer will expose the separation. One exposure was the Mount of Transfiguration. He took three. Then he go, and there he is in Gethsemane. That's another exposure. He prayed, and he takes his disciples, and then he brings his 3 a little further with it, but then he had to leave the 3. Jesus didn't go a little further just physically. In the spirit, he went further.
Yes.
They got sleepy because they couldn't hang with the dimensions he was in.
Come on, Jesus.
This is like I'm telling y'all about Smith Wigglesworth and the dimension he was praying in. People used to make bets about how long they could stay in the room when he prayed. They used to make bets about it. Pastors used to make bets of how long we can stay in this room as long as he prayed. They used to make bets. And one time somebody made a bet, and they were in the room, and they was all praying, and then Smith showed up, he prayed, the room filled with so much glory. The testimony said people were crawling out on their hands and knees because they couldn't handle the depth of the glory. Y'all ain't hear me. And then one person in bed, that Joe would stay there as long as they could. He couldn't stay. The last person in was Smith himself in the dimension he was in by himself because he acclimated to a dimension they weren't acclimated to. So when Jesus was praying, their spirit man shut down.
Yes,
Lord. They got sleepy. And he said, you couldn't even pray with me for an hour? He said, that's easy. An hour is easy. That was the least. You got to become a woman and a man of prayer.
Yeah.
And I'm not talking about this pity pat stuff. We've been doing it so long and no results. That the minimum of prayer you need to spend is an hour with God. I set a challenge to people, and I sent it out and said, you need to make it an hour with the Lord Jesus. Now, who did it? I don't know. But still, you need to make it an hour. That's the minimum. Because if you can make the foundation an hour, it's nothing to get there, and then you build from it. Oh, we want more glory. What kind of time have you been spending?
Come on.
It's my question. You
have to know what you're praying for.
You're praying to be crushed in your flesh so spirit man can arise.
Yeah.
So it ain't, oh God, I'm going to say it like this. Hallelujah. Got to say it. It ain't the church fault where you go. Is what you've been doing in private is the problem. If you ain't been doing nothing, that's the results you're going to get. What if all of us, everybody, be so, I mean, making 2, 3, 4, 5 hours in prayer daily, and then we come together? You ain't going to be able to stay up. Folks will be falling out soon. Soon somebody open their mouth. It can be anybody. It can be anybody. Say it be like your boy. Man. Why? Because that's the dimension we raised to. We don't raise to it, you ain't gonna experience it. You expect, oh God, we want the glory to fall. God said the glory in you. Let the glory fall. Glory in you. You release what's in you. You are an open portal. Last thing. I'm just trying to shift our mentalities, man. We've been saying stuff so wrong for so long, asking for stuff God already put in you. But you won't cultivate the time to get it. You wonder why Smith Watkins, John G. Lake, Catherine Coleman. See, Catherine Coleman was one who, she was married, but you know, of course, she got married wrongly. So she had to leave that alone. God checked her. She had to not be married no more in that capacity. So she ended up marrying God. She was single and she minded the things of the Lord. And so she would spend, this is why when she walked in the room, the atmosphere was electric. She would spend like up to 13, 16 hours in the presence of God. And when she showed up at the airport, they had to shut the airport down before it was falling out under the weight of the Lord. Many times when she showed up at a place, they had to take her through the back room. Because when she passed by, folk fall out. That's because she married God. She spent so much time with him, his presence was just heavy on her, and she just gave it away. She barely ate. That's why she was so thin. But we like the shallow pool. And we like to dangle out of the feet here. That's what we like. But then we cry out for deep, but then you like shallow in your own personal time. Right. Give us deep things, God said, go get them. You seek after deep things. The spirit man searches the depth.
Yeah.
So stop crying out for what you won't go after.
Come on.
Peter ended up having a spiritual revelation of the identity of Jesus, but he also had a spiritual barrier to the will of Jesus. So in that moment, he said, hey, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. He said, flesh and blood ain't. No man revealed that. Spirit talked to your spirit. Ooh. But then, in the same breath, let me read it to you real quick. Matthew 16:21. From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem, and he must suffer many things from the elders and the chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and be raised up the third day. Say, that's the will of God. But Peter wanted to take Jesus aside. Now notice, Jesus already knew what he was going to say. But he was so accessible to Peter, he allowed him to go aside. Come on, y'all ain't with me. Jesus was a leader that was accessible. But he also was a leader that put people in the right, proper places. Woo! Anyway, Peter rebuked Jesus. How you gonna rebuke your rabbi? Most folk are so dishonorable, they don't know order. So many folk think they so high-minded and so big in the spirit, they want to rebuke up. Don't worry about that. You bring concerns, you're not a rebuker. My God. So now, since you want to rebuke me, I got the right to say this. Peter like, far be it from you, Lord. This shall not happen to you. He turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are an offense to me. Why? Because you are not even mindful of the things of God, but you're mindful of the things of men. You don't even know what dimension I'm speaking from. That's why you're trying to rebuke me. See, his spirit man was in, Jesus' spirit man was in tune into seeing and hearing the spirit that was talking through Peter. He said, all right, I see what I'm dealing with here. Because I'm in tune. Satan, you get behind me. Because you're using Peter, who the Father just used. You're using the same Peter. This is how easy it is to get in flesh and or spirit, just that easy. Out of the same mouth, blessings and cursings come. So in 1 minute, he blessed the Lord by recognizing who he was, because the Father spoke spirit to spirit. But then there's another spirit that creeps in after the Father speaks. Have you noticed the pattern?
Yes.
That when Jesus was baptized, the Father spoke. Right after he was led into the wilderness, Satan comes. Right after the Father speaks to Peter, it was all good. Next moment, there's another spirit coming. Get behind me, Satan. I recognize your patterns. When you don't recognize the pattern of Satan, you will always be deceived into thinking it's God. That's why the Bible says that Satan is the one who comes to steal the word.
Come on, Jesus.
So what happens is, this is what's going to happen. I'm going to go ahead and warn you. This is what's going to happen to you. I just preached this word to you. You're going to leave here. You're going to need to give a text, Facebook message, Facebook post, a call, a conversation, and somebody gonna make you mad, somebody gonna argue with you, somebody gonna do this and that to steal this word as soon as you leave. They probably before you leave, hallelujah. They gonna do something to be an offense to you to steal this word from you.
Come on,
come on. I just gave it to you. Some of y'all mad right now. You already become an offense to yourself. That's how he steered the word. He steered the word through other folks. He steered the word through saying something or doing something to get you aroused to not even think about what has been implanted into you. Steal it from you. And now instead of you living out what's been preached, now you go out in your flesh. Anger steals the seed. Strife steals the seed. Arguments will steal the seed. All that, it steals the seed. I'm trying to tell you now what Satan's going to do. So I'm already warning you.
Come on.
And it's going to be somebody you're familiar with, you close to. Somebody you got access to. And you let in your world. Mama don't come with me with that. You know, your mom come and they want to stir up stuff. Mama don't come with me with that. I'm talking to you young folk now. Mama.
Hello.
She said, I'm talking to her. Mama, why you say that? Still in the word. Because mom don't even know she's an agent of Satan.
Jesus.
Your children don't know. Your husband don't know. Your wife don't know. Your friends don't know. They're agents of Satan. I'm telling you, they come in the package of who you're familiar with, and they become agents of Satan at the moment to steal the seed of the word. You ain't heard something all this time from this certain somebody, and you've been expecting it, and you got denied. Oh, Lord, you've been looking for this. You've been looking for acceptance. It ain't going to deny. Oh, Lord. And it comes right after the word.
Come on, Jesus.
The rejection comes right after the word. So instead of you living for your spirit, man, you go all in the flesh. You ready to cuss folk out? You ready to throw your phone? You ready to beat somebody up? Hallelujah. It's all in the form of stealing the seed. I'm trying to help you. Because when you leave, it's going to happen.
Yeah.
You just got to lie down, whatever.
Yeah.
Learn how to navigate it for your spirit, man. Everybody stand. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Woo! Satan is not coming to you with a pitchfork and horns. This red man ain't coming in the form Hollywood has presented. Ghosts and ghouls and goblins ain't coming. He coming in the form of that fine person you like. He coming in the form of those that know how to get on your nerves. He coming in the form of those that know how to push your buttons. They know how to make you angry. They know how to irritate you. They know how to frustrate you. And you're like, I just got out of church. Why are you coming at me with this? He knows how to come in that form just for you. He knows your trigger points. He knows how to push them. And he coming for the trigger points. He coming as your children. My Lord. He coming as your husband and wife. Folk that you're friends with, that you thought were cool. Folk you want to be with. He's coming in that form. The familiar places he's coming. See, he gonna come in a deception where you can't recognize as him. That's how he come. Where you can't recognize as him. So he come in the form of your mama, your daddy, your auntie and uncle. Folk you respect. He come in that form, folk you take care of. He come in that form so that the word can be stolen and you can get all in your flesh, man. That's what he want. Because he know you ain't going to live out what's been stolen.
Jesus.
Thank you. Woo! I'm helping somebody. Mofo, you know, we'll preach these ABC words and then these words don't even help us navigate life.
Yeah.
I'm having you navigate life. Because if you can learn how to live from the Spirit, you won't fulfill the lust. Lust deals with strong desires, what your flesh desires to pull you into. What is your flesh pulling you into, y'all? God said, you gotta walk in the Spirit. You gotta walk contrary to what it wanna pull. So I gotta build up my spirit man so that my spirit man can fight for me. Because it's a war.
Yep.
Say it's a war.
It's a war.
But if my spirit man weak, he can't fight. So I fall prey when I have a weak spirit. P-R-E-Y. You ain't a predator. Because the predator is what your flesh wants. So the predator mentality of your flesh pulls you into being sucked up and devoured. But your spirit man said, I'm going to be built up so you won't be prey no more. It won't beat you up. You won't even have that desire. That text that used to come that arouse you. You see that text? That's nasty. You got to get to a point. That's nasty. You can't woo me with that no more. My spirit built up now. Sugar daddies you got, let them sugar daddies go. They want you with all that money. Oh yeah, girl, you come up, I'm gonna give you $1,000. Man, you nasty. I'm right here, hey, it's life. People do it, because flesh. It's the life of the flesh. Hopefully, I take your $1,000. You nasty.
Not
all. That means you nasty head cheap. You need to be top shelf material. I'm at a top shelf. You can't reach me with that. Hallelujah. Anything top shelf is rare. Come on. I'm a rare breed in the earth. Come on. You can't just come up to me with anything. I'm a rare breed. Your spirit man worth something. God said, I see it as precious. So I live from that place. They can't keep duping you if you understand how valuable you are.
Woo!
I love it.